Welcome to the Grace Abounding broadcast, sponsored by the Congregation of the Shreveport Grace Church in Shreveport, Louisiana. My name is Ken Weimer, and it is my privilege to minister the Word of God for you today. May the Lord Jesus Christ be praised and exalted through the message preached, and may He, by His Spirit of grace, grant ears to hear to each one He came to save and ransom by His shed blood on the cross. Here in Numbers chapter 15 and verse 37, "And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, Speak unto the children of Israel, and bid them that they make them fringes in the borders of their garments throughout their generations, and that they put upon the fringe of the borders a ribbon of blue." That's the old way of spelling ribbon. "And it shall be unto you for a fringe, that ye may look upon it and remember all the commandments of the Lord and do them." And here it is. "And that ye seek not after your own heart and your own eyes, after which ye used to go a-whoring." Now, we use some kind terms, don't we, to describe, well, I made a mistake, or I got off track, or I wasn't thinking. But really, to be left to your own devices and to follow your own way, the Lord calls going a-whoring. That's a strong term, I know, but nonetheless, it is to follow your own way. That's exactly what it is before the Lord. It's a spiritual adultery. "That ye may remember and do all my commandments and be holy unto your God. I am the Lord your God, which brought you out of the land of Egypt to be your God. I am the Lord, your God." Well, after learning last time in this chapter of God's provision by the law, that's what we looked at last time, for the pardon and mercy of sinners. And we saw that the law itself does not leave anything, any small detail or even any small disobedience alone. The law has to condemn it. That's why the law is not a friend. People that try to obey the law, thinking that somehow they're going to find acceptance with God, they're going to find a rule that can only condemn. Because it not only condemns your acts, it condemns your thoughts, it condemns your motives. You hear most people we talk to, they say, well, when I get to heaven, I know God's going to probably weigh out the good that I've done versus the bad. Now, wait a minute. First of all, who said there's been any good that you've done? And who says that it's limited to what you've done? See, this is what the thinking of the Pharisees, when Christ came, they thought, well, I haven't murdered, I haven't stolen. And Christ had to tell them, if you've gotten angry with somebody, you've murdered. You think about anger. When you think an angry thought towards somebody, that's that same expression left out of control that causes people to kill people. So you can't judge yourself less of a murderer just because you've never physically maybe killed somebody. You're just as guilty. That's why Christ said with regard to adultery, you know, you may have never touched another person but with your hands, but Christ said if you've looked on them and lusted after them in your own heart, you've committed adultery with them. So the law judges not just what we do, but what we think and our motive. And in that regard, all of us, If God were to deal with us based upon our obedience to the law, He'd have to send us all to hell, every one of us. But then when you say, well, where's mercy found? That's what we looked at last time, in the blood sacrifice. In every case, the Lord pointed the children of Israel to, that's what those sacrifices were about in the Old Testament. Every time a lamb was slain, it was to be a representation of the work that the Lord Jesus Christ would come and accomplish. And then you say, well, what did the lamb do? Nothing. That's the point. But substitution is the Lord laying on another the very guilt that you and I deserve. And that's what He did with His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. He bore the chastisement. The chastisement of our peace was laid upon Him. And by His stripes, then, we're healed. That's the only way we can find satisfaction before God and forgiveness of sins and be justified. It was in His death that He justified His people. So
So we saw that the last time, even the sins of ignorance. Remember that that's the word that's used there in verse 24, then it shall be if aught be committed by ignorance. And we saw the explanation of that. It doesn't mean, oops, I didn't know, but it's talking about even secret sins without the knowledge of the congregation. Now, if there was such a one that committed such a sin, it says there the whole congregation had to come and offer it. What affected one affected all. And we looked last time at how that's a picture of Adam. When Adam fell, we all fell in him. So the deliverance requires the same sort of remedy. There has to be a representative that represents those that God has purposed to save that will die in their place. And that's what the Lord Jesus Christ did. Even as we fell in Adam, we're made forgiven in the Lord Jesus Christ. Even as his disobedience brought condemnation, so Christ's obedience brings life. It's justification of life. That's why the Lord saves us, is because of what Christ accomplished. I know some people fuss about that. They say, well, I don't think it's fair that I should be judged based upon what Adam did. Well, regardless of whether you think it's fair or not, that's how we live, isn't it? Isn't it by representation? We've got people sitting in Washington making decisions for us right now, today, that are going to affect our livelihood. Whether we think it's fair or not, you know, they're making the decisions. Representation, that's just the way it is. In the bottom line, I'm thankful it is by representation. Because if I fell in Adam, that means my salvation then rests in another as well, not in me, but in the Lord Jesus Christ. And it's by his doing and dying that the Lord receives us. So that being so, and as you read the scriptures, you're going to see the legal satisfaction of how God can be just and justified set forth. But on the heels of it, you're also always going to see a call to those that he's redeemed to look to him, to seek him, not to rest in yourself in any way. And that's what we see here. We come now to this part here where it's an urgent call to sinners to run from any seeking of glory yourself or seeking of any following your own will or your own works, but to wholly seek the Lord. Wholly seek the Lord. Some people always find a contradiction with that. I don't. You know, they say, well, if salvation's of the Lord, then why call sinners to seek him? Well, it's because the Lord has commanded it. And that's what those that he's redeemed will do. When the Spirit of God so draws them, they will seek him. They're not going to look to themselves. They're going to look to him. So let me just give you these two points to take with you out of this portion here. First of all, those who are the Lord's, they're not to seek their own. Why? Because they're not their own. They're not their own. That's what I see here, commandment that the Lord gives in verse 37, 38. It might seem a little bit unusual, but remember that the Old Testament was a book of types and pictures. So everything in it, from the priests to the sacrifices to the temple, these were all types and pictures of salvation, of how God's pleased to deal with his people. And so the Lord commands them as a result of this to make them fringes in the borders of their garments. And it says throughout their generations. So the Lord has purposed now to distinguish this people in a very particular way from everybody else around them. Aren't you distinguished by your dress? You look about the different cultures throughout the world and how different ones dress. You can tell pretty much what their heritage is or what their culture is. There's a certain way that identifies different cultures. And here the Lord purposed to identify this people by their dress. Why? Because they're not their own. When you stop and think about why they're here, he chose them out of all the other nations. There you have electing grace. He purchased them. He brought them out of Egypt through the Passover lamb. And now he's brought them into submission to himself, and he's going to distinguish them from all the other nations around by this dress. It's a type. And what was it? Well, it was a fringe on the border of their garment, a ribbon of blue. That's what it says here in verse 38. All right, so you say, what's this all about? Well, blue is always used in Scripture as a color. It was in the tabernacle. It was the same thread that was used to describe that which was heavenly. divine significance. And so this was one small way of God putting his mark upon these people and letting them know that they're not their own, that they were bought with a price. And that little fringe of blue around the bottom of the garment, every time they looked at it, that's what they were to remember. As he says in verse 40, that ye may remember and do all my commandments. Now, you know, I know there's some people that try to always go back to the Old Testament and they keep trying to implement these things as if, you know, that we're still to do these things today. Well, one problem is we don't all dress that way anymore. And secondly, when Christ came, he fulfilled all of these types. There are some that even argue that when Christ came, he actually would have worn a garment like this. They refer to the woman that touched the hem of his garment and refer to that hem would have been something like this. I don't know. I do know that he fulfilled all things. And so if this was a commandment, certainly you would expect maybe that that was the case. I don't know. But the point is that the Lord Jesus Christ, in every one of these types, there's a fulfillment in the Lord Jesus Christ. So what we have to do today is look at the lesson that we can get from such a border. Now, this is where the Pharisees, you remember the Pharisees, always took the word of God and, like men will do, through custom and tradition, add to it in order to build themselves up. And so you remember that this was the habit of the Pharisees. The Pharisees enlarged the borders. This was supposed to be just a ribbon. Now it has become an actual garment. And we've seen this in society. If you've ever attended a graduation, you know, you can tell who got the bachelor degree, who got the master's degree, who's the doctor. It's all according to ribbons that they got on and wear. And I kind of think that maybe this is just a carryover from religion. You see them with all these tassels and everything, and it's a badge of honor to distinguish yourself from others. The Lord never purposed it for that reason. In fact, he never made a distinction between Moses and Aaron and the others as far as the ribbon. You notice here it just says that they put the fringe of the borders, on the fringe of the borders, a ribbon of blue. These words are important. It was never designed to be a show of spirituality, but a remembrance. Now, bring this over into our day. Isn't that what we do with everything that the Lord has even ordained for the church? We're going to make a show of it. Whatever happened just to the simple Lord's table with the bread and the wine? Very simple. But what do men try to do? Spruce it up, try to add to it. They try to make it a merit. We're going to allow certain people, but not others. And then even those that we allow, we're going to do it with some fanfare. So now we get the golden goblets and we get everything spruced up. You see these people walking around in robes like the old priests again, you know. Let's clear the air here with some incense and we're going to take some water and sprinkle on. All this hocus pocus. In fact, do you realize that that word hocus pocus is Latin? You go back and look at the tradition of it. It is Latin for what the priest pronounces over the bread and the wine, thinking that he's going to transform that bread into the actual body of Christ, and the wine actually becomes his blood. You go back and look at the origin of hocus pocus. That's where it started. It's Latin for transforming that. It has just become something else than what the Lord purposed it. Why was the Lord's table given? In remembrance of his death, in remembrance. When he said, "This is my body," he wasn't actually saying, well, by having that in your hand now, this has actually become Christ's body and you're actually eating his body. It was a type. Isn't the same thing with baptism? The Lord, why does the Lord ordain baptism? There's no merit in the baptism. There's no grace in the water. All the grace of God is in the blood. It's in the death, burial and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what baptism is about. That's why we immerse. But don't think for a minute that somehow by you take a dead sinner and plunge it in the water, all you're doing is bringing up a dead, wet sinner. Baptism doesn't save. It's what it represents, the death of the Lord Jesus Christ. So again, we see that the Lord gave this as a remembrance, as a reminder basically whose they were. And we need those reminders, don't we? We need to be reminded of that every day. If you look over in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, this is a fringe on a garment. It's a blue ribbon. It's not the garment. And I think about that with regard to my righteousness before God. My garment is Christ. I put on Christ. Now, there are effects. There are fruits of how that manifests itself in my life if I'm the Lord's, but I don't put any confidence in the fruits. My righteousness is still the Lord Jesus Christ, who he is and what he accomplished in his obedience unto death. He's all my forgiveness. He's all my justification. He's all my righteousness. He's all my sanctification. And that's what we see here in 1 Corinthians 6 in verse 18. It says, flee fornication. Every sin that a man doth is without the body, but he that committeth fornication sinneth against his own body. What, know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you? And that's talking about that body of believers together. That's why everybody had the same robe. Everybody had the same fringe. It was all a reminder of whose they were. And that's the same thing with salvation. We don't have degrees of holiness. We don't have degrees of righteousness. We all wear the same robe. If there's any fringe of blue by God's grace, it's all the glory still goes to God. We're not going to enlarge these things and make this one to be a little bit higher than this one in the realm of spirituality. No. Notice, know ye not that your body, that is the entire, there's one body. The church is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own. And that affects how we deal with one another, doesn't it? If the Lord's redeemed you and he's redeemed me, I have no business putting myself above you or you putting yourself above me. We all share the same love of God. We all share the same grace of God. We all share the same redeeming blood of Christ. We all share the same righteousness in the Lord Jesus Christ. That's our garment. And the fringe of blue is just, it's nothing but his grace manifest to us to constantly remind us whose we are. Here's the reason, verse 20, for ye are bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Isn't that our desire? Wasn't this fringe of blue, wasn't it the purpose to glorify God? As it says there in verse 40, be holy unto your God. How am I holy unto God? In the righteousness of Christ. I don't trust in any other righteousness. I'm the Lord your God, which brought you out of the land of Egypt to be your God. I'm the Lord your God. It all has to do with glorifying him. All right? So that's the first thing. And then the second here is in verses 39 to 40, coming back to Numbers 15. Those who are the Lord's, again, by election, that's how we're the Lord's. He chose us by redemption. He bought us with his blood. And by regeneration, that's how he calls us, by his spirit. But we're a particular people. I know the scriptures use the language of peculiar people, but that word peculiar is really the word purchased. You're a purchased people. This fringe served as a reminder to that end that they were the Lord's particular people. It shall be unto you for a fringe. Now don't get boasting in it. I love the doctrine of election, but I don't boast in the fact that I've been elected. I don't take that and enlarge that border and say, you know, this is, you know, I'm somebody. I got chosen. You know how kids are when they're picking up sides. if they get chosen first, that's not what this is about, election. Redemption's not that either. The fact that, you know, Christ died doesn't well me up with pride. It humbles me to think that he would die for a sinner like myself. But that fringe of blue, that grace that the Lord is pleased to give me, which adorns my walk and my habit, because that's really what a dress is. It, all the glory belongs unto him. You know, it was never designed for the trimming or adorning of their clothes, but to stir up their hearts and minds by way of remembrance. And that's what Peter does. If you look over in 2 Peter chapter 3, As you hear Christ set forth, how does it affect your own mind and heart? Does it make you boastful? Does it make you feel like debating? Does it make you feel like going out there and fighting with it? Or does it humble you? I believe it humbles the Lord's people as the more we learn of Him, causes us just to marvel at His grace. You know, this is again what Peter says here in 2 Peter 3, this second epistle, beloved. I now write unto you in both, and he's speaking of the first and this one, which I stir up your pure minds by way of remembrance. You say, how can you have a pure mind? Well, only in Christ. It's how God sees us in him, that knowledge of Christ that he's been pleased to reveal in us. That's his spirit in us. But what does it do? It stirs up our minds by way of remembrance, that ye may be mindful of the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets, and what? And of the commandment of us, the apostles of the Lord and Savior. You know, we don't find these commandments, these gospel commandments, to be grievous at all. When the gospel commands us to look to Christ, we do so willingly. When the gospel commands us to bow and submit to his righteousness alone, we do so willingly. Those aren't grievous. When the gospel commands us to repent of every false way, of every thought of our own. And that's really what this ribbon was designed to do. In essence, it's as much a reminder as this word right here. This is a reminder of the Lord's commandments that we seek not our own heart or follow our own eyes, because to do so would be to go whoring. All right, so again, sadly, many look on these ornaments, these graces, to feed their pride. But I'll tell you, to do so is to miss exactly why the Lord has even given us his grace. It's not for boasting. The goal of these fruits, just like that psalm writer said, the bride eyes not her garment, but her dear Savior's face. That's what all of this is to be remembrance of, his grace. And don't you know, in wearing those garments, wouldn't it be a deterrent in the face of temptation? If this is what you have constantly had before your eyes. That's why we constantly need the word before our eyes. We constantly need to be hearing the gospel. We need to be hearing Christ set forth, because it is that which turns our eyes away from ourself and the way we would go, and causes us to constantly remember him, remember Christ. And I believe in that same way, that garment, that fringe, was given to the people of Israel, much as the grace of God through the gospel affects the hearts of God's children today. Oh, that he would grant us these times of considering him and looking to him, hearing the gospel. And hearing it set forth, not as an option, won't you please, but a command. You realize the commands of Scripture are just that: repent, believe. These aren't options. You're not doing God a favor by repenting. You're not doing God a favor by believing. A lot of preachers present it that way. Don't disappoint God by going out of here today without repenting. That's not how the gospel's set forth. The command is to repent because of who he is. And just like here, you say, well, why this? Well, verse 41, I'm the Lord your God, which brought you out of the land of Egypt to be your God. I'm the Lord your God. Shouldn't that suffice? Shouldn't that suffice? Well, how we need to hear the gospel and to treasure up in our minds, in our memories, the very image of Christ and his work, in his sacrifice, and what he accomplished. That is the way of righteousness. And in that, it keeps us from any form of idolatry. If you look at 1 Corinthians 10:14, think of those things upon which your mind is dwelling right now. We're about ready to close down and walk through those doors and head out into another work week. But what is it that drives you? What is it that motivates you? What sorts of thoughts, even now, in the face of, you will, this fringe of blue that we have here in Scripture, of the grace of God? And, you know, how does that affect your thought process and decisions that you have before you. Well, I trust that hearing this would cause you to slow down and think a little bit about what I have to do, what I have to say, how it can glorify my Lord. Here in 1 Corinthians 10, in verse 14, you see how all of this has ended up. Wherefore, my dearly beloved, flee from idolatry. What is idolatry? It's covetousness. Isn't that usually what gets us seeking after our own heart? The lusts of the flesh, the pride of life. These are things that cause us to wander. And my prayer is that the Lord would cause us to stand, hearing once again of whose we are and what Christ has done for us, that it would certainly direct our heart and mind. Over here in Colossians chapter 3, you see here in verse 1, this call, if ye then be risen with Christ, if when Christ died and rose again, you were in him, and you were, if the Lord chose you and Christ died for you, even though you were not yet born, that death was on your behalf. That rising again was for your justification, or because of your justification. God justified you in him. Seek those things which are above. If the Lord's taught you of Christ, that's where you're looking. Where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. I can't see him with my physical eyes. I've never seen Christ with my physical eyes. Sometimes if you shut your eyes and you get an image of Christ, it's only because of what people have taught you. You've seen a picture somewhere, and so that's your view of Christ, but I don't know what he looks like physically. I wait to see what he looks like, you see. But to see him seated there just simply means to understand your position in him. As he's seated there, why is he seated there? Well, he's conquered. He came to satisfy law and justice and rose again and sat down. Those high priests in the Old Testament could never sit down. But he finished the work. He sat down. I rose when he rose. And I've been taught of him. Then that's where I see my hope. Seated right there. All right? So it says, set your affection. You notice that? That it's just one. It's in the singular. That word means set your mind on things above. That's saying the same thing as back here, that ye seek not your own heart and your own eyes. Why? You can't seek your own when your eyes set on him. It says here, set your affection on things above and not on things on the earth. You're dead. When he died, I died. So legally, I have no business seeking my own. And your life is hid with Christ in God. And when Christ, who is our life, shall appear, then shall ye also appear with him in glory. When you think of that fringe of blue, think of him who's seated in glory. That's what the blue of the tabernacle was all about. It had to do with heaven, with glory. Therefore, it says, mortify your members which are upon the earth. We still have to deal with this flesh. Fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection. Who's he talking to here? He's talking to believers. I hear people say, well, once the Lord converted me, I never had another lustful thought. They're lying. They're lying. We struggle with these things. Otherwise, why would we need the commandment not to seek after your own heart? If that heart had been made pure, in that sense, mortify, though, those members which are upon the earth, fornication, uncleanness, inordinate affection, evil concupiscence, and covetousness, which is idolatry. That's the sum of idolatry right there. Coveting after something that the Lord never purposed for you to have. Seeking it. For which things sake the wrath of God comes on the children of disobedience. It doesn't mean it'll come on you for disobeying, but it's the children of disobedience are those that God's passed by. I'll just close with this. As it says in verse 41 of Numbers 15. Numbers 15, 41. I am the Lord your God, which brought you out of the land of Egypt to be your God. I'm the Lord your God. Well, I pray the Lord will bless that.
You've been listening to the Grace Abounding broadcast brought to you by the Congregation of the Shreveport Grace Church in Shreveport, Louisiana. We meet at 2970 Baird Road and invite you to join us each Sunday beginning at 10 a.m. For more information, please visit our website at www.shrevegrace.org
or call 318-687-4943. Please plan to join us again next week.